glad to be here this afternoon with Mama O, and thanks everyone who's sticking around for this wonderful breakout session. It was a great day yesterday, great evening, really inspiring morning, and looking forward to continuing the conversation with Mama O. So for those who don't know her, she is an Appalachian of mixed ancestry, and she, it's not just Mama O, it's Omope Carter Daboiku, and
Omope Carter Daboiku.
Daboiku. She hails from Ohio River town of Ironton, migrated to Cincinnati in 1972 and to Dayton in 2012. A cultural geographer and award-winning teller of tales, Omope became affiliated with the Ohio Arts Council in 1990 and the Cincinnati Arts Association at its inception in 1997, and has performed and led story circles across the United States and abroad. And for us, the most important part of Mama Omope's story is that she became involved with Agraria a few years ago.
Yes.
We're so glad about that.
So
you were one of the first fellows that we had, and then became our first artist in residence and did some amazing workshops here at Agraria. And this is a continuation of that.
Yeah.
And we're also happy that she's become part of the staff.
Yeah.
So looking forward to this afternoon. Thank you so much.
I feel like a rescued puppy who's found a forever home. So that's what it says on paper. I am so pleased to see 27 of you. That's a good group. That's a good size. As Susan said in the bio there, that I indeed do hail from southern Ohio. Some people say, oh, southeastern. And I say, no, there's nothing eastern about Ironton. And if you're really from Ironton, or you know people from there, you know that we are real hillbillies and we pronounce it Arnton. There are no O's in Arnton. Just like here in Dayton, there's no T. So how did I come to storytelling? I sat and listened to my parents and my grandparents and was an obedient child because the rule then was to be seen and not heard, preferably not seen, so that you could overhear adult conversations. I became my family's formal historian at the age of 25. That responsibility was given to me by a first cousin once removed who informed me that it was not a democracy and that I had no vote. I just had to assume the position. And so I learned about research when I was doing studies in cultural geography. Some people asked me, you are going to be a geographer. What you going to do with that? I said, study land and people, research and write. Well, it took a little over 30 years for that to manifest, but that's exactly what I do. So I must say that I was totally engrossed and inspired by Chef Twitty's presentation. I'm currently reading his book, The Cooking Gene, and I am delighted that a person younger than myself is at the place where they can tell the stories and put them in print and give them to people orally and in archived versions. So today we're going to talk about what it means to tell stories, because that's what we all have gathered here to do, is to share story. Now, I'm not going to be in performance today. That is not my goal. My goal today is to be able to pull stories from community, tell you how to enhance them, how to categorize them, and how to make them more powerful than simply a conversational anecdote. So the first thing you have to do if you're going to tell a story is understand what the purpose of the story is going to be. Are you telling the story so that you can keep history? Are you going to do it in a timeline? Is it personal? Is it organizational? Is it about your town or your city? Is it about shifts in patterns? Or are you going to tell a story trying to make an impact on the future? Telling a story is what your business plan is. Do you have a need to expand your story? Are you going to run a capital campaign? If you're going to do that, you're going to have to be able to tell your story effectively. Is it something you want to reflect on? Some struggle that you're currently in or that you've overcome? If that's the case, then your story is going to be designed to inspire and to give advice. Maybe it's also designed to keep people from falling in the same hole you saw along your journey. Perhaps your story is going to be a call to action. You want to insert policy changes. You want to inspire people to move on an idea. You want to expand people's understanding and their capacity to dream. Or perhaps it's a memoir, a family anecdote that's personal to you, the organization's story, whether it's going to be a written memoir, or are you going to trust the oral tradition and pass it on? In my own Ellis family tradition, every time we have a family reunion, which is an annual event, on Saturday, we hold what we call the Ellis Round. And we have gone from the first generation of our known roots and told stories that were told to us. Then the next 5-10 years, we told stories about those who started the reunion. And then now that circle is at my generation, and we're listening to our children, our grandchildren, and great-grandchildren tell the stories that they remember hearing from us. Memoir can be powerful throughout generations. Okay, so Rachel and everybody else promised you that this is going to be an interactive workshop. And so here's the first piece. I am going to share, and I'm calling this a story overheard in Louisville. And once I tell it to you, and it's just going to be a short little snippet without many modifiers, we're going to take 3 minutes after I share it, and we're going to think and scribe, and you can put your ideas in the chat, about some possible scenarios that could be included in the story to enliven it as a shared experience. So if you are the person who was telling this story that I'm about to share, I thank you for gifting it. Don't tell a story in public with a storyteller there unless you want your story retold. So I'm going to thank you for your permission and tell this brief story. Once upon a time, there was a Kentucky farmer who found himself on an unfamiliar road in Indiana. He needed to find the correct bridge to get back to his farm. Now, that's a sentence. That is also a story. The teller had angst in his voice, but he didn't share many of the details or relevant facts that would have made it clear why there was tension in his voice. So let's take 3 minutes on your own, put your thoughts in the chat. What are some possible scenarios, some more facts that could have been included in the story that would enliven it as a shared experience and help us understand the speaker's angst? Don't forget who, what, when, where, and how. Take 3 minutes starting now. And I won't sing. Can you read the sentence one more time? Okay. There was a farmer from Kentucky who found himself on an unfamiliar road in Indiana and needed to find the correct bridge to get back to his farm. Expound on that story. Why? What facts or feelings are left out that don't share with the listener why the speaker was feeling so stressed? You could hear it in his voice as he told that story. Evening was drawing nigh. Well, what would he have feared? What would have been the danger, Sharon? Because he didn't say, but I could hear it in his voice. Cross burning, he saw in the distance. Sundown town, says Patty Allen. Yes, those types of things cause stress in us. What mode of transportation? He was going by car. His wife was having a baby and he didn't. She was in labor and bleeding a lot. No, it doesn't include childbirth, but thank you for that. The farmer was carrying cattle. He only had enough food to feed them for a certain amount of days. That's a nice one, Kelly. Weather conditions or time of day. Yes, the sun was setting. The shadows were getting long. Ooh, yes. Yes, it is a ooh. Okay, 2 minutes. One more minute, whispering forests. How did he get lost? He made a wrong turn, Kush. All righty, the chat's getting a little quiet. So let me, because someone had stolen his map. See, Bree, if he was using old-fashioned technology, he'd have had a map and a flashlight. But I think what he had was a cell phone and no service. All right, so are you ready to see how close you got? Somebody put a thumbs up in the chat and I'll know when to start. He had a situation and he needed to space it, so is there not times to be lost? Yes, that's true. Okay. Ready? Yes, the person was African American, male. Yes, he was lost in Indiana because he made the wrong turn off of the main highway, which had black asphalt. And the further he traveled, the lighter the road got. And he finally got off of asphalt and got onto gravel. When he got onto gravel, he knew he was lost. It was an unmarked dirt road, which meant it had no signage saying what number it was. So he assumed he was probably on somebody's private land. The sun was going down. He was depending on his cell phone, which was running out of energy, so he didn't have much light. He couldn't use it for light. And he was also in enough rural Indiana that he had no cell service, so he couldn't use the internet to get a MapQuest situation to know where he was. And as some of us know, Indiana is the state in which the Ku Klux Klan was formed. So knowing these entities, these little elements that he did not put in his story, changes the whole nature of I got lost trying to deliver some chickens to I was terrified on a dirt road in Indiana as the sun was going down. I couldn't find my way back to the Ohio River. Somebody says they got lost like that in Virginia. My people from Appomattox, Virginia, and I was down there when my great uncle had no electricity or running water or in his house. We loved going down there because we could play slam dark. Slam dark is when it's so dark you can't see your hand, all you can see is stars. Those experiences make for great stories. So we're about to do this piece now, and I'm deliberately not sharing screen with the outline for this session. I want you to trust, as Chef Twitty said, we gotta relearn how to trust our gut, not only for what we put in it, but for that seed that's right there where the solar plexus is that remembers everything. We've been trained to paper and pencil. We're from cultures that held everything in their memory until we wrote it down in forms that were not using Phoenician letters. So if you couldn't read the symbology, then the medicine was only available to those who had been taught how to read the certain signs that were used for documentation. So we don't have to have a shared screen with the agenda if we trust that we're going to be able to remember everything that we heard. However, because this is the 21st century and we have to adapt and use the mechanisms that are given to us, along with the recording of the session, the outline will be available after the conference. Okay. All right. So what are some of the storytelling processes we can use to preserve a story? Well, most of us think first an audience, that it's going to be a mouth to ear experience. It could be from radio, it could be in a large auditorium or a small intimate circle. It'd be in person. And nowadays, as we're doing now, it can be broadcast virtually. and available to everybody around the world. There are some of us that still like to hold paper and to see things printed, but now you don't have to wait to get an agent. You can self-publish. You can create a newsletter that can be downloaded and printed out and shared. You can also blog. So we've got all these new ways to see things in print, whether it be on a screen or on paper. Then your stories can be posted. Social media platforms and private networks, subscriptions. I'm not necessarily most comfortable with that, but the pandemic and being quarantined taught me that if the digital square was going to be the new commons and I wanted to remain relevant, I had to begin to understand the technology that was being used in this generation. So I encourage all of us seasoned individuals to find someone younger than 30 and have them teach you how they use social media. And of course, then there is archive audio, which is different than sitting in an auditorium and listening with your ear. In this category, we're talking about podcasts, archive virtual and audio presentations, and dedicated websites. Style changes just like the weather, just like we change our clothes, style shift, and we transform with available technology. The mechanicals then influence how we can share the story, and how we can preserve the story. So we go from radio to transistor. I can remember my first transistor radio. I thought I was so cool because I could take my music with me wherever I wanted to go. Yes, I'm telling my age. For broadcast TV, from waves going through the air, being caught with the antenna on top of your house, to chip and microwave technology so you can stream and you don't even have to watch regular TV. Recording in progress. So what receiver mechanisms, from circles with elders to artistic performances in front of non-relative audiences. So as we are receivers, we might choose to receive our story from elders sitting in intimate circles. There are now storytelling networks that do broadcasts. You might be able to catch the Story Circle from Michigan. They broadcast every Wednesday. There's the Columbus Storytelling League here in Ohio, and they broadcast monthly. And how do we get the story out? Always on a wave. Always on a wave, because the sound coming from our mouths is a wave regardless by the thing that's being being received. So we can transmit these stories orally, mouth to ear, printed with downloadable files, the short form, anecdotes, jokes, poetry, PowerPoint presentations on software and apps like PowerPoint, Canva, and WeVideo. Or they can be long form, longer videos that we might call a movie, a video, a commentary, or a debate. So at this time, I do believe that my technical folk behind me can post some thumbnail icons of some of the documented story that I have kept through PowerPoint and WeVideo. If you guys have that and can share that at this time.
You know, I actually was looking for it. Did you send it to me by email?
I did.
And okay, let me take another look here.
But I thought I sent it to both of you.
Okay, because I don't recall getting that.
Okay, well, we'll tell you what they are. There's one that I did for the Ohio State University. They were looking for something to inspire their graduate students to reach out to undergrads and bring them into plant pathology. And that's called Choose Wisely. And I did it with PowerPoint and just written narrative. But the PowerPoint reflects what the narrative is. I'm one of those people who hates to go to a workshop and have people read to me what they posted on the screen. So I was trying to put pictures that would support the language, and I had a separate script. So what people were watching was parallel images to the script that I was reading. So the script was not on the PowerPoint, just bullets were on the PowerPoint.
Mama, I actually found, I think I just found it. Okay. So are you looking for the Choose Wisely slides?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, let me pull this up for you. Thank you.
And then there's another one that's the documentation of my mother's family's history called Ellis Migration. And then there's one that I was in with the National Park Service's Underground Railroad Network to Freedom that says, it probably just says Omope 1, but it's about being at an Underground Railroad workshop with no Underground Railroad story. And what I had to do was go beyond myself, beyond my own family, because my family came north in the 20s. But what I was able to do was to focus on my father's interaction with small independent Black churches that had been centers during that transmission of people during what we call the Underground Railroad. So you can see here, this is about negotiating your career path and deciding what your personal journey was going to be. So when I chose these graphics, I chose them to tell a specific story. I wanted something that was stylistic, but not yet cartoonish. So we've got the croaker sack. Y'all know what a croaker sack is, right? And it's the woven twine sack that's the big thing in the back. And then in the front, it's got a pot with a sprout. And then this here in the front is a watering can, although somebody looking at it might think it was a long-handled cooking pot. So that graphic was my stylized thing. Then over here on with my left is probably your right, is a long piece of land that's planted in patch style. I am a proponent of patch style growing. It is part of our indigenous and African agricultural practices. It makes harvesting so much easier than long row growing. Long row growing is about using the body like a machine. If you grow in patch and the patch is only as wide as your arm can reach in, you can do the whole patch in 30 minutes as opposed to having to walk down a 25-foot row round and then back up another 25 feet and walking 50 feet. You've worn yourself out. Down here on the bottom are pieces of the image is kind of bleary, but I think those are agricultural products that, and herbs that would live in your house. So nothing on here blatantly screams out plant pathology, because the intent was to create something that would inspire people and not frighten them with deep technological language. There is one slide in here though that has got so much technological language and color and numbers, and I put on there, for those of us that don't interpret this type of information well, this looks like spaghetti. So you have to know your audience to know how to give them the information that you want. You got to see, yeah, thank you for going through that. You can go through it a little slower. Yeah, there you go. What's your personality and organizational type? Do you work better alone or in groups? Here's some experiences of what's beyond the hoe and the shovel. Then this is, see that pathogen right there? He's the thing that's causing all the disease in your farm. And I had to tell our agricultural educators, we don't need to know his Latin name. We just need to know what we need to do to get rid of him. Because his name is pest, or his name is disease. Okay, you can go forward on that. And this is for you science types, because they're always the ones who know what they're talking about. And it's a simple graphic that uses technological language, but doesn't overwhelm you, so that you can see the story and then you can read the story. Now, this is one of the ones that I was saying got a little too much action for those of us who might be diagnosed as dyslexic. I had to actually use my finger to trace some of these lines to see what they were, where they went. But it is, it's a great organizer for those who can read information organized this way. Advance. Now, I like to pronounce this, don't be scared. Don't be scared of the big words. Take a Latin class if you must. Don't be afraid of being alone. You know, most of us who are fearful and experienced, the thing that's really the most fearful thing is being vulnerable enough to become friendly to people, because we're so guarded in fear. So you can't be afraid of being alone. There's somebody else there who needs a friend as badly as you do. And remember that shift is the only thing that's constant. All righty, thank you for that, Rach. It is now about to be 2:34. This is another one of those things, that screen right there was another one where organization is done in silos and then color-coded, and using color sometimes is not important. I was doing a residency at a school recently, and the teacher had 32 contacts for me, and each one of those contacts, she had shaded a different shade of color. Well, for me, the color meant absolutely nothing. And so it just blurred the whole story for me. I couldn't even articulate what class was coming because my eye was distracted by the color that she was using. So I took a great big deep breath and I asked her if she could redo this schedule without adding color. And then after she gave it to me, I asked her, how did adding color help you in your organization of this material? Because for me, it didn't give me a story, it just confused me. So sometimes we can add too many elements to a story and it really doesn't have the impact that we mean for it to have. So we're about to do this break and everybody's probably worn out today if you've been sitting for a long time, because I know nobody wanted to get up while Chef Twitty was talking. I know you didn't want to do that, because I didn't want to do that. We didn't want to miss anything he had to say. So we're getting ready to take a 10-minute break after I make this announcement, and I'm calling it the TCOY break, take care of yourself break. While we're on this break, you're going to go to the bathroom, get some water, do some food, stretch, do whatever you have to do to take care of yourself. But while you're moving about, you're going to begin to think about your own group choice and the questions that you want to prepare in your head for your breakout session. There will be four groups, so that you might choose either the memoir anecdote group, the commentary essay group, the personal story group, or the organizational story group. In that breakout room, you're going to have 10 minutes to be in circle, to share an idea of a story you want to develop. You are not going to be telling each other stories for 10 minutes, because when we come back from that break, each group will have 5 minutes to bring forth their story that they want the group to critique. If that is understood, let me see some thumbs up in the chat so that I know that I've articulated myself clearly. If I didn't, give me a thumbs down in the chat or in your reactions on your underneath the little thing. Okay, Sierra, thank you for that thumbs up. Can somebody list the four categories again? Sure, Arlinda. They are memoir and anecdote, that's one group. Commentary and essay, that's a different group. Personal story, that's the third group. And organizational story is the fourth group. Clear? They're separate. Memoir and anecdote are in the same group. Commentary and essay are in the same group. Personal is one group and organizational is a different group. And if you can't figure out which one you want, I bet you one of these technicians can shove you into the one that needs somebody. Okay? All right, everybody go take care of yourself. You got 10 minutes. We'll get back here at 2:48. Thank you. You better take care of yourself.
I love that. Oh. I'm always momming people as the Zoom host. I'm like, is everyone drinking water?
That's right.
Is everyone using the bathroom? Is everyone eating food? Don't be cranky.
That's right. That's right. And if you need to eat and drink, just stop your video so we don't have to watch and be jealous.
Yeah. That coffee was delicious.
Good. That was okay. I had the honor or displeasure of monitoring a 6-hour-long storytelling conference.
Oh my gosh.
The Ohio Storytelling Network.
6 hours?
And I told them, oh, it was so wonderful, everybody from everywhere. And I said, we will never have a 6-hour online conference again where I had to talk and pay attention for 6 hours.
Did they feed you?
No, how were they going to feed me? I was in Dayton.
Oh, is it virtual?
It was virtual.
You better take care of your business.
They should have at least sent you a gift card.
Well, you know what? I learned something. It was a very important lesson, which is that was very ambitious. We did it, and we patted ourselves on the back for having done it. But I was so glad that I understood that I didn't have to let them watch me watch performers perform. So after I would introduce somebody, I'd hide my video, go to the kitchen, open up the refrigerator, and get something and come back and just be smiling.
Yeah.
Oh, I swore I'd never do that again to myself. That we as an organization should never do that to ourselves or even to the attendees.
But the organization should know that storytelling is so powerful.
It was the beginning of the pandemic. Of the quarantine, and everybody was just trying to write and trying a way to keep the organization intact, you know. Would you type groups into the chat? Sure.
I'll take care of that, yeah.
Thank you.
Yes.
Ah, that's why we was getting the echo of you.
Exactly.
So you need me to read them again, or you got the paper, Rachel?
I got it.
Okay.
I'm gonna do personal. So.
Okay. We'll see which one that goes in. Look at you, getting everything you can. Ain't nothing wrong with that. I'm so glad you chose to come.
I am too.
Is that Sierra? Sure. Make yourself comfortable. We're on a 10-minute break. We got 7 minutes left. Oh.
There's always one person at each of our conferences I've noticed who will have their video on and they're just knitting.
Yeah.
They're just there knitting and it's so wholesome. I love it so much. There's always one person and it makes me so happy.
You know, that's one. I was trained to the needle. That's what I call it. The summer that I was porched.
I tend to make.
Do you while this is going on?
And I just have it set up in my kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
Because I'm one of those people that I get really exhausted. I'm a little bit more alert and I'm also doing the work and then mm-hmm. just jotting just a little bit that I can remember.
I never learned to knit, which is fascinating because I play multiple instruments that require both hands, but some about that. I don't know because I couldn't make the needles click the way my auntie did, so I felt like I was a failure. I don't know. But knitting didn't take for me. But after these Zoom things, when they first started, I felt like I was in a classroom and I had to pay attention to the teacher standing at the board. And it took me maybe that second year to realize that staring into the camera 2-3 times a day was ruining my eyesight. It was taking my eyes.
If you were zooming from home,
yeah.
Why are you to
leave
your camera home?
Well, see.
Probably a year after pandemic.
Yeah, there were people, well, especially employees, because they wanted to see you while you worked. They're like kind of like Big Brother. But there were people, in groups that I was in who were hesitant because of their own mental psyche makeup. They didn't like being seen, and they needed some filter, some screen.
And I took three classes where presenters required that you also keep your camera on.
Mm-hmm. See, I'm not like that.
They tried to do it like the brick and mortar institutions.
Yeah.
But after the second year in the pandemic, it was like, you know what, be safe and show up.
Well, you know what I say is, if you got your video off, they ain't gonna see your naked booty when you stand up, cause we know you ain't got no bottoms on. So hide that. I think so. Okay, so we got, is that 4:46? We got 2 minutes, 4 minutes.
You don't trust these filters. Sometimes they blink off.
I'm looking, I'm trying to see that little number down. Oh, it's a little closer to me here. Yeah,
244. Are we starting at 246?
I think it was 47 when we left out.
I should have looked at the time when we, oh, okay, thank you.
On the
they said 248.
Yeah. Now, Rachel, I'm realizing that I'm looking, when I look forward at the screen, I'm actually looking up. And your green dot on your camera, so when I look at it, does it look like I'm looking forward at the screen?
Yeah, when you look, yeah, it looks like you're looking at us
now, right now. Now it looks like I'm looking directly at you. But mm-hmm. if I look at the screen, it looks like I'm looking up at the ceiling of the barn.
Mm-hmm. It looks okay. Like you're getting a message from...
Oh, I am, actually. I'm trying to be in. I actually am.
Sometimes I'm like reflecting, or like I feel like I'm getting some sort of message. I like have a tendency to like look up at the window or.
Yeah, I remember one of my first revolutionary acts was looking up with my eyes open during prayer at church instead of looking down with my eyes shut. It's called, I'm not doing that. I'm going to look up and anticipate my blessing. Like they do in Hawaii.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Nah.
I feel like looking down always gives me that feeling of grieving. It's not receiving as much.
Well, for me, I understand it. It's supposed to be in a position of submission. But that's only if you think of yourself as a child of God and not a part of the Godhead. Since I'm part of Godhead, I got to look up. You know what I'm saying? Because that's the source, right? So, although when I'm farming, I always look down. Because that's the source. You know, I had people, I managed the incubator farm at Edgemont for Central State. And I had people want to tell me they want to have a more spiritual experience, Mama O. I said, son, the first way to do that is to take them ear pods out your ears. You can't hear the earth talking to you, even with the smooth jazz going on. You ain't gonna be able to anticipate that there's a big chunk of rock.
Right.
And when you hit it, if you got them ear pods, then you ain't gonna hear the birdie that's gonna chirp and make you look up, and you gonna miss it in the rock.
Yeah.
So until you're ready to act like it's the stage at the Apollo and rub the shrine before you step on the field, don't ask me for what you ain't ready for. And it's hard for people to hear me talk like that, but hey.
I always get worried I'm gonna hit a critter or something. Like if I'm not looking where I'm like putting a shovel or something, like I'm gonna hurt a bug, or I always have to look.
Folks was having cultural conflict where they thought that numbers meant that they got to decide what was gonna happen on the land. And I had to help them understand this was an equal opportunity experience, and that everybody on the land didn't want to hear music. So they could sing to themselves, but they weren't going to broadcast music across the field.
Yeah.
I was just having a conversation when we were on the bus about professional projections on what a successful farm is.
Mm-hmm.
It was related to the numbers and production, the pounds of food that you're pulling out these vacant spaces. And so I may know that everybody's profit is not your dollar bottom line.
If you all read the Black Farming Network, that's exactly what I wrote about.
That's my only way I survive.
Because
it's
we were. That's right. That's
dollars.
Right. I don't understand the difference between anecdotal and personal. The anecdote might be about somebody else. It could be somebody else's experience that you overheard. It could be a joke that you heard that you're sharing with somebody else, you know? Oh, great, Sharon. Do you hear these people chuckling behind me?
Everyone just like felt that ooh.
You know, when people ask a question, since I've gotten to be this young, I realized that, you know, my daddy used to say the only question that you should be ashamed of is the one you didn't ask. So, you know, you got to realize that everybody don't know everything. That's why we ain't one great big body. Knowledge had to be separated into pieces so that we could be harmonious and everybody come together and share. Because I got a piece of the puzzle. Sierra got a piece of the puzzle. Sophia got a piece of the puzzle. What's your name, sister? Lavonda got a piece of the puzzle. And until we all recognize that we're not complete without each other, then we always be walking around with our ego out of joint.
I love where people are brave to ask questions that they won't normally ask at like an Ohio Extension Educator event.
Mm-hmm.
I love when they ask those questions. Who else is really answering?
All righty, so it's the 50, which means everybody's back. What's organizational storytelling? Hey, Raheem, organizational storytelling would be that PR piece you're trying to write about the farm that you run or the nonprofit that you own or the place where you volunteer. And they've said to you, like they said here to me at Agraria, tell our story for us, please. And so in the doing that, I've got to do the background on the organization, look at the organizational growth, what was the founder's intent? What's the future hold? And take all of that together and then massage it for the public so that when they read it, they've read the past, the present, and the future. You get that, Raheem? Asheo. Thank you. I do bad. All righty, everybody back? All right, Sister Rachel. Ready. So how shall we do this? You want to give the explanation of how to get into the room that they want?
Yeah. So when I say go on the Zoom, everyone should see a little pop-up. And so you'll see the name of the room. You click it, you say join, and it will transport you there. And I have it so you don't just get a 1 minute warning when it's going to end. You get, I think 120 seconds, because sometimes it's nice to know I've been there. So you'll have 120 seconds. It's a 10 minute meeting. And just a clarifying question, Mama, is do they have to pick one person to share, or how will they designate?
Yes, one person is going to come back and give us a brief synopsis of the story that they wish to give us for us to enhance. The way I demonstrated
5 minutes.
The first story where I gave a sentence, and then, because you're going to do more than a sentence, though, but you're going to come back with one story, and you'll have 5 minutes to share that story and get some input. So it could be somebody's story that they're already working on. Maybe somebody's working on organizational plan, and they say, can we do this with my plan? Or maybe it's all of you who decide you want to talk about a similar experience. So I'm trying to give you some latitude, because I don't want to give you a template that you have to do hard and fast. That takes the creativity out of it. You got to sacrifice a little security for creativity. So let's pick.
All right, opening all rooms.
I was sitting in the barn, and the group in the barn was in the personal story workshop. And because I was in that, this group will go last. Don't be afraid of anything because everybody's nervous, including me, because I don't know how well this is going to work either. Okay, so everybody drop their fears. So group one, memoir and anecdote. Let your person who's going to be the spokesperson unmute yourself. And then you have 5 minutes for us to polish your story. Once you tell it, then we'll have 4 additional minutes to polish. So who is the spokesperson for memoir and anecdote? Kelly, that's going to be you.
I don't know if it was me.
So did the anecdote memoir group choose somebody as their spokesperson?
Well, I was telling this more details in our story, so I'm sort of thinking it might be me.
So let's hear this. I choose Elizabeth, Elizabeth. Somebody picked you, Elizabeth. So just share what you all did. Don't worry about it being polished. Just tell me what happened in your group.
A lot of discussion about what we were supposed to do. So we just barely started on a story. We had
Stop. What you're doing now is telling me facts. Give it to me in a story. We started in blah, de, blah, de, blah, and then such and such and such. And then we realized again, I want a story. I want you to put all of that in a narrative, Elizabeth, and tell me a story.
So we started in our group with having difficulties. Someone couldn't talk. Someone could only chat. We got one chat that talked about the generation of their family. And then we were able to then talk about another story that involved a family camping trip.
And tell me what happened on the family camping trip. Why did the person share that? What was so significant about that?
Well, it was the mother's first camping trip. The father was an experienced camper in the wilds of Minnesota. Their children were toddlers, 2 and 6, and none of them had been on a family camping trip. Mm-hmm. Accessibility magazine talked about, we'll start in your backyard. Well, we didn't do that. They wanted to start in the wilderness. Well, some of them, one person wanted to start in the wilderness. And so being nervous, the mother wanted to talk with the forest rangers, and they weren't very helpful, but taking the canoe out into the wilderness, getting separated at some times from kids and parents, and pitching a tent next to a tree that looked like a cat scratching post. And then later that night, the mother was still up, as mothers sometimes stay up late, and heard this lumbering sound, and it stopped by the tree, and this big scratching sound came along. Well, and the next day out fishing, the father was having the best time fishing, and another canoeist came along in this wilderness and said, was that your camping site back there? And the mother heard was, as in past tense. And the canoeist said they saw a bear tearing down their food pack out of the tree. So the mother's wanting to go back to civilization as quick as possible, but it's coming on the end of the day, and in the wilderness you have to get back to your campsite. And again late that night, about same time, this lumbering sound comes down the trail, and the mother says to the father, that's the sound I heard the night before. And assuring her, the dad says, that's the and it got quiet. And then all of a sudden there was a snorting sound on the side of the tent by the kids' sleeping bags. And the mother let out a scream because those were her kids. And she kicked the father out of the tent with some, they wouldn't have the metal pans or anything. They just had some wire handled fly swatters. And he went out of the tent yelling and clicking the metal handles of the fly swatters. And turns out everyone else around the lake that night got hit by that bear, took bread from one site, chicken from another, but they heard the screams across the lake.
That was excellent. Once you put yourself in story mode and not reporting mode, the whole energy shifted. Did you feel it?
Yes.
Good. That's exactly what was supposed to happen. Thank you so much for taking that risk to report for your group. Because when you said it looked like a tree, you had such great detail. Because immediately when you said they picked a tree that looked like a cat scratching post, I knew exactly where that story was going. Because I'm a country girl. I knew that was a bear tree. She evidently weren't no country girl. Or else she put her head there. But that was great. I felt the tension. I felt the parents cross-eyeing each other, you know, and the one looking at the other one like, why you drag us out here to have this experience that we ain't having no fun by? I think it was great. Thank you. Thank you so much. Everybody clap. Thank you. All righty. See, now you did the icebreaker. It's going to be easy for everybody else. Thank you for taking that risk. The next group is commentary and essay. Can we see that group, please?
Hello.
Hello. Okay. Hi, Arlinda.
Okay. How you doing, Mama O?
I'm good. You going to be the speaker for everybody?
Yeah, I'm going to be the speaker for this group. And you say it's easier after that previous. I don't think it's easier, Mama O.
Girl, see, that's called.
We're going to do this.
That's called self-cursing.
It is easier then. Let's get on.
Let's do that.
Let's just do this thing. Let's just do that. I want to have the right answer, so we're going to do it.
Nope, there is no right answer. Didn't you watch the Kung Fu? There is no secret ingredient. It's
okay, faith. So I just want to understand the format. So you want us to go on how we formed our story and then tell you what the story is?
Yes, please. That would be great.
Okay, so I have to say, had the loveliest group together. We were awesome. And we spent the first couple minutes just admiring, like first we admired some artwork because Raheem's jewelry that he makes, this healing jewelry is on the screen like this. And I was like, you go boy, because it was awesome, right? And so he explained about healing crystals and things like that. And then we came together, it's like, all right, what are we supposed to do? And like, and we had a lot of different ideas from a lot of different people. And so what came down to it is like Yolanda had like this inspiration from somewhere. I don't want to say Sunny name, but it was a higher power, right? And she was like, hey, the queen just died. How do we feel about that? She didn't say it that way. She said it in her way, but that's how I interpret it, right? Mm-hmm. So we were all like, you know, she said basically, hey, Black people aren't reacting to the queen's death the same way that everyone else is in the world. You know, maybe there's a commentary essay around that. And then like, you know, everybody else jumped in and said, ooh, that's a good one. So we kind of stuck there. We didn't even explore any other topics because it was awesome right where it was. So then, you know, so Jennifer, so we started bringing in some other concepts and we brought in the how about the fact that you can only inherit certain land if you already have a title? So then we talked about, what about the accident of birth? Are we supposed to admire her more than someone who was born of a peasant because she accidentally was born of a king? Now, what does that mean for our commentary, right? So we started kind of going back and forth and exploring all these different areas of like, what does it mean honored and what does it mean to be esteemed, and did the British Empire really do well by the rest of the world? I mean, who didn't they conquer, right? So we were going through all those different stories, and so what we came up with was our essay. So what we decided our commentary was going to be and our story was going to be is Raheem was exploring the internet to try to find places to market his healing crystals that he makes. And so as he was exploring the internet, he came across a couple of stories about how the queen has passed after 96 years. And he thought to himself, I'm not so really moved by that story. is there something wrong with me that I don't care as much as the other people seem to care about the passing of the queen? So is there something wrong with me? And then he turns the page and starts to look at other places where he can market his jewelry. And he decided, I'm not going to really worry about that right now because I got bigger fish to fry than the passing of a 96-year-old woman that ruled an empire. That's our story.
I must say, I must say, your point was well made. Short and sweet commentary. Because somebody, you know, it's been amazing watching this whole thing. I've been paying attention for maybe 65 years. To the British aristocracy before Downton Abbey. I was already, you know, when your grandparents are born in the Victorian age, you get them stories, right? And the one story about the family, when William, who is now the Prince of Wales, opened his mouth and said, "Why, my family has never been racist." I thought, you need to shut up and go to Oxford, someplace where they can give you a real education that you ain't getting around your family's dining table. But the one story about Elizabeth that I think relates to us is she was never trained to be the monarch. Her daddy was the spare, like Harry is the spare. Her uncle David was the king, and he abdicated the throne to marry the American woman that was twice divorced, Wallis Simpson. And when his brother had to assume the throne, no one in that family was happy. Nobody, because Elizabeth's father stuttered, and he knew that he was the second and he was the spare. And he never, ever intended to rule as king. His wife had the opportunity to court David. She married the other one because she didn't want to have the head of state responsibility. And here they were trying to outrun their destiny, but it caught up with them. That's the story, that each of us has no idea what mission we will be called to. Because we think that maybe the circumstances of our birth indicate what our destiny is. And that's not true. You only know the destiny by the challenges that you get. So I am really, Rakim, I'm so glad that you challenged the whole international boo-hoo-hoo party for Elizabeth II. What I started doing when I heard it was like, oh, so Charles about to be the king. And Willie about to be the Prince of Wales. Everybody get a new castle. Because I'm thinking family dynamics. I'm not thinking governmental. But I was surprised at how many of the former colonies are still part of the Commonwealth. And that she had the wherewithal to figure out how to shift that relationship from being the autocrat to being the healer of the nation. There's going to be a lot of stories written about her once the dust settles and we get okay with enough distance. But thank you for bringing that dichotomy. That's really great. Everybody clap. All righty, righty, righty. Personal is last. So let's do organizational. Was there an organizational group? And if so, who is the spokesperson? Nobody went into the organizational room. Rachel, was nobody in room 4?
Yes, somebody was in there.
Okay.
I nominate our Black lady ukulele player, if she's still here. Right here.
There she is.
And I nominated.
I nominated you. If you want to pass the nomination up, you can.
We second that.
Oh, good. Okay.
No, we're in tandem.
We going to share and you were going to play the ukulele. I like that kind of behavior.
Okay. Well, I would feel blessed to have a little music in the storytelling.
Yeah.
Okay.
Your community calling on you, Sister Kelly. Oh, you cannot renege.
That's what I'm talking about. Queen Elizabeth is also the descendant of Queen Sophia.
Oh, it's more of a sister. Let's see. Oh, my gosh. We need. All right. Mm-hmm. Well, have you ever looked at an oak tree and seen like little dots up and down the tree? Well, around here, when you see a tree like that, it's not a cat scratching it. No. Or a bear clawing at it. It's a woodpecker. Yeah. And a woodpecker, you know what they do? We think that when a woodpecker's pecking, that they're actually pecking for bugs. Really, they're knocking. They're knocking for bugs. Kind of knocking and waiting for the bugs to come out. So I feel like sometimes when we go into like a room where we don't know people, we're kind of like those woodpeckers. We're just knocking on ideas until somebody comes out and starts talking. Yeah. So one day we were in a Zoom room. A Zoom room, you know, that's a room that you're not really in, but not you really are. And there were a couple of people in there. And like woodpeckers, they just started knocking on ideas. You know, ideas like asking questions like, where are you from? Are you in graduate school? What kind of plants you growing in your window? Where you driving to? Like woodpeckers, they kept knocking until something came out. Something they could eat and munch on and chew on. Yeah. And they realized that everything in the room was shifting. And they went from people talking about graduate school and growing gardens with children and working on conservation. And they ended up shifting from strangers to friends.
Yeah.
What can we be when we shift our ideas? Who can we be? Can we make this world a better world? Can we shift what's going on? Can we shift what's going on? Can we shift what's going on? Shifting for a greener world. Can we be?
Okay.
Woo! Woo! Out of there. You put the together.
Wait. I just want everybody to know this. When this goes up, there will be a fee to watch it. Oh, I'm making
it. Amazing.
Kelly, let me say this to you. I didn't know till I saw Johnson City. That's another black hillbilly right there. Shout out all us black Appalachians. Thank you. Thank you to your group for allowing that to come forward. So Sophia's sitting over here and she said, and why we got to be last? Sister, okay, so when We're gonna have to do this again. You have to give ukulele lessons. We will be in touch.
I travel.
Excellent. Yes, ma'am. I'm pre-clanced right now. It take a lot to take words out of my mouth, but that did it pretty much. Wow. You did that in 10 minutes. Thank you for letting your group lean on you so heavily. You came through. Thank you. Thank you so much. All righty. Well, I got Miss Bugs over here, Ladybug Farms, right here to my left. And I'm going to step out and go back so that they can come forward and be. What?
Just turn this.
Well, no, she's behind me.
Oh, I move.
Yeah. Go over that side.
I'm going to just get off. I'm going to leave all the way.
There we are.
Okay. Okay. Can you all hear me? Excellent. My name is Sophia Bugs. I'm owner and operator of Lady Bugs Farm. And sharing what would be more personal is my personal expression to how we personally collaborated in a wonderful space that we maximize our time and our energy to focus on getting to know each other. And with very little time, we figured that we would just share the name of our city and something about who we were or what we presented. And I sort of kind of weaved it together like it was a quilt. So with no names, we have an opportunity to kind of hear how, what we look like in a space together. So I'll just kind of share from Lexington, grower, healer, educator is on the move. Freeport, New Jersey, skater, dancer, biological medicine. In Indiana, we've got someone definitely supporting food justice. Wooster, musician, singer, justice seeker, someone who I would have never would have shared that information. Columbus, backyard farmer and grower. Chicago, researcher, creator, interpreter, wayfinder, urban farmer, medicine woman. And this what it looks like for people to come together to maximize their time in a very simple yet unique way, so that we will never forget who we are in collaboration and uniquely individual. So this is my personal story of how we personally connected doing the assignment of Mama O. Thank you.
Everybody clap.
You know, in this little piece of curriculum here, it said that a story can come out like a poem. And poems don't have to rhyme. They are about rhythm and cadence. And all you young folk who know how to spit understand that it doesn't have to, you know, be roses are red and violets are blue. It really can be flow of consciousness. So I would like to take a poll. If you enjoyed this opportunity, put something in the chat or in your little reaction thing for your icon photo that tells us that you liked it, that'll be a thumbs up. That you loved it, that would be the heart. That this is something you'd like to see happen and you'd be willing to do it again. Give that little one that looks like the celebration with the horn with all the confetti coming out. That way we'll be able to do a real quick survey of satisfaction, how you liked it, or pick the one of your choice. Some people like hearts and some people like diamonds. So thank you, Sierra. Thank you, Isaiah. Oh, this is, you loved it, did you, Raheem? Thank you. Thank you so much. So that'll be the way we will do the evaluation, and we'll know just how much you valued this. If you want to send a message to me at OC, that's two letters, Daboiku, daboiku at agrariacenter.org. I'd be happy to receive any email from you, and I will answer questions. And if you'd like to do this again, say so in your email to me, and we'll figure out how to make it work. Because we've got these stories. Some are very obvious, and some are not as obvious, and they're all worthy. And if we don't tell our stories, somebody will tell a different version that we did not articulate. Okay? All right. We have done this so well. We've got some little bit of minutes left. Ooh, let me pat myself on the back. Because, you know, when I run this in my head, I can't necessarily time it out. But I want to thank you so much for your participation, for your cooperation, for your willingness to walk on out there on that board. All was underneath you was ocean. And you knew that you couldn't swim in the ocean, but you walked the plank anyway. Thank you for your sharing your risk and your vulnerability. Before we end here today, I want to say to you something that's very important. When I was 9, I told my parents I was going to be a writer. And as I got going through my life, my mother informed me that I could not be an artist because she didn't give birth to any artists, because artists were irresponsible because they didn't get regular paychecks. And so I should be a teacher. So I went to go be a teacher, and then I wound up one day and everybody was rushing out for lunch. And I didn't know until 4:30 why everybody left at lunch. When I got to the bank, there was no money in the account. And I wasn't getting no regular paycheck. So I decided that I loved my mother, but she was not going to define my future from the grave. I continued to work and work, raised my kids. They graduated one thing, then they graduated the next thing. Then the spirit blew me out here to Agraria, where I get to rest, relax, farm, and write. So 61 years ago, 61 years it took for me to be able to say, yes, I am a writer. I want to share this with you. It's on page what? 25 in this journal. There is no 25 at the bottom of the page, so you had to look for 24. So there's nothing on this. But it's a poem that I wrote when I first moved up to the Miami Valley. And I started calling the volunteer hours at Edgemont Solar Garden, the Church of Dirt, because during the quarantine, we could open up the greenhouse, be masked in the greenhouse, and it gave people something to do. And I scheduled those hours during the regular church hours because Dayton is a church city, but almost all of them were closed. So this poem reflects life before I came to Edgemont Solar Garden, and long before I knew anything about Agraria. Worshiping at the Church of Dirt. Made prayer with the earth this morning and turned soil as penance to call upon spring. The snow-fed soil gave easily to the shovel as the clods revealed fresh meat for the winged ones who visit me daily. The coffee can chock full of composted scraps was dumped and covered with the petition for a good crop of whatever would be planted there. A plan to cover the poison ivy vine with clematis and roses emerged to eye and nose, futuristic sensory camouflage. Two stray bulbs sang their identities and said where they wanted to go, as four V's of geese, 8 in each, announced their journey no further than the lake north of where I dwell. So, how do you like Dayton? Is a common repeating question for those who know I sat in another place for over 30 years. I look at them trying to figure out what they really want to know. Just what are they asking me? There are libraries here, art museums and exhibits, gatherings for poetry and theater, families cooking out in the park. I'm sure there are bars with babes and dudes posturing for digits and friend requests on social media, hoping sparks will fly and loneliness will flee. It is, for some, A shrunken town of abandoned houses, indebted students, military veterans, and frustrated workers who were gainfully employed until Mr. Charlie took his jobs and ran for the border. A food desert created when farms became suburbs, cut off from the city by a concrete path siphoning dollars out of communities that limp along hoping for a better tomorrow. But if an answer is necessary, I guess I like it here. I feel needed and appreciated. And as long as I can worship while digging in dirt, my soul is happy, the ancestors are smiling, and so am I. Thank you all for sharing this time for me and letting me be your guide as we explore our initial tradition that we brought to these shores, how to keep story alive through oral engagement and how to capture the essence of your experience. Thanks for listening. See you soon.